place the ability try to come to the United States. If in the arbitrary detentions. This would be a very important contribution to international relations going forward, and this is something that the United States and Canada will work on. There are legal questions that are appropriately the province of our Department of Justice. They follow the law, they follow the facts, and I'd refer you to them for anything on the legal aspects of this case.
Andrew Mitchell.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Given the fact that the CIA has concluded that Mohammed bin Salman personally approved the killing of Jamal Khashoggi, can you explain why he is not being punished in these decisions? And especially since the president, when he was a candidate, told me during a debate that he would make Saudi Arabia a pariah state for what it had done. Well, and could I just also ask about sure. Saudi Arabia's reaction now? The foreign ministry is saying that they reject the negative, false, and unacceptable assessment in the report.
Well, Andrew, I think the report speaks for itself. And I think you've seen today a number of very important steps to recalibrate the relationship. First of all, the release of the report itself and the transparency that that provides. This is a report that in a sense is not fresh off the printing press. It's been there. Released it. We were determined to bring transparency to this issue and to share with the American people what we know. And again, I think that report speaks for itself. But beyond that, you've seen a number today of very concrete steps that are both looking at past conduct, but as importantly, looking to the future to prevent future conduct. The Department of the Treasury is sanctioning former Saudi Deputy Head of General Intelligence, Ahmed al-Asiri, for his direct role in the Istanbul operation that murdered Mr. Khashoggi. We're also designating the Saudi Rapid Intervention Force as an entity under the Global Magnitsky Act for its participation in this murder. We have taken action pursuant to what we're calling the Khashoggi ban to impose visa restrictions on 76 Saudi individuals believed to have been engaged in threatening dissidents overseas, including but not limited to the Khashoggi killing. And importantly, we have introduced and announced a new policy that will apply the State Department's ability to restrict and revoke visas to any individual believed to be involved in extraterritorial activities targeting perceived dissidents or journalists, trying to harass them, surveil them, harm them, or their families. Because this practice, this conduct, whether it's by Saudi Arabia or anyone else, is totally unacceptable. And we now have a new tool to push back against that. More broadly, I would say the relationship with Saudi Arabia is an important one. We have significant ongoing interests. We remain committed to the defense of the kingdom. But we also want to make sure, and this is what the president has said from the outset, that the relationship better reflects our interests and our values. And so what we've done by the actions that we've taken is really not to rupture the relationship, but to recalibrate it, to be more in line with our interests and our values. And I think that we have to understand as well that this is bigger than any one person. This recalibration goes to the policies that Saudi Arabia is pursuing and the actions it has taken. And I would just add and conclude with this. We are already seeing some results from this recalibration. We're seeing results in our own efforts, joined, I hope, by Saudi Arabia to end the war in Yemen. We're seeing the new policy approach we've taken to arms transfers and getting back to regular order with Congress. And I think that overall, we are doing what the president said we should do, which was to review the relationship in its totality and to make sure that it goes forward in a way that better reflects our interests and values.
Hello, Mr. Secretary. I want to follow up on Andrea's question. You talked about preventing future actions, and you have unveiled a new ban, Khashoggi ban. but you have fallen short of punishing the very person that DNI has said is responsible for this. So how are you, because of this lack of accountability, how is that not counter to your actions to ensure accountability elsewhere in the future? Isn't this counterproductive? And also on the arms sales, what is the US thinking in light of this report to arms sales to Saudi Arabia? I know that there's a review, but how can you justify going ahead with those arms sales after this report?
Thank you. First, with regard to arms sales, you're exactly right. There's an ongoing review. And there is a very important distinction between our commitment to not engage or not support offensive activities and operations in Yemen, including through the provision of offensive weapons, and the legitimate needs of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia in terms of its own defense, something, as I said, we remain committed to. So we're reviewing these arms sales, and we're making sure that going forward, what we do provide goes to the defense of the kingdom, not its ability to prosecute offensive operations. And the other thing that's very important about this is that as we go forward, we're going to do so in full consultation with Congress, something that we've gotten away from in the past. And so we're going to get back to regular order, not just with Saudi Arabia, but with any country with whom we were engaged and are selling arms to and providing security assistance to. So that, I think, is very important. As to accountability, again, I think this report speaks for itself. And the fact that we have provided the transparency necessary to shine a bright light on what happened through the assessment, not just of the media, as important as you are, but the United States government, is in and of itself, I think, significant action. And beyond that, for Mr. Khashoggi not to have been murdered totally in vain, we now have in place a new policy that applies not just to Saudi Arabia, but across the board, and that gives us, I think, a greater ability to deter the kinds of egregious actions that were taken against him and against other dissidents, opponents, and others speaking out, or their families going forward. And that, I hope, will be, in some small measure, an important legacy.
Time for one final question.
One quick thing on Mohammed bin Salman, can the U.S. still do business with him? And then on Syria, what message do you hope Iran gets out of the U.S. strike on Syria yesterday?
As I said earlier, the relationship with Saudi Arabia is bigger than any one individual. The president engaged, as you know, with King Salman. I've spoken to my counterpart, the foreign minister. Secretary Austin has spoken to his counterpart, who happens to be Mohammed bin Salman. With regard to the strike in Syria, we had on multiple occasions in the last 10 days or so, attacks on our people, our position, our interests that took lives and injured others. And so we had both to respond to those attacks, but also to an ongoing threat that was very clear. And so we took this action that I think was focused, proportionate, but also effective in degrading some of the capacity that the militia in question had to perpetrate new attacks. And also to be very, very clear, notably to Iran, that they cannot act with impunity against our people, our partners, our interests. And I think and expect that message was clearly received. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Iran.